Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Will to Love group and is part of the Education in Love series. In the Rewards of Developing My Will to Love presentation, Jesus encourages us to see that God is good and offers many gifts no matter what we do, but also offers additional personal and collective rewards that come from our choice to develop our will to love and obtain an education from God. Recorded on the 27th of February 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right, so our topic for discussion now is this topic of the rewards of developing my will to love. It might seem that it's a waste of time going through this particular thing because the rewards would be obvious, but obviously the rewards are not that obvious because otherwise we'd probably already be doing it, right? So this is why I felt that we needed to finish off our discussions with the discussion about the rewards of developing your will to love. Now, I thought the best way to introduce this topic was to ask you again, what are the causes of pleasure and pain? And let's focus now only on the cause of pleasure. What's the cause of pleasure? So if we come to Ange down here.
Using my will in harmony with God's love and truth.
Yep. So can we say it another way? Using my will in harmony with God's love and truth? Or using my will to not sin? Or using my will to... not to break God's laws, using my will to not break God's laws. Pleasure. Pleasure is a good reward, isn't it? Don't you think? So isn't that a beneficial reward for developing your will to love? And if we weren't so nuts, we'd probably say that that's probably the only one that really we have to have, isn't it? Without having to need another 25 other, obviously, rewards to discuss. To me, that reward should be enough to motivate us to want to use our will to love. And isn't it wonderful in a lot of ways that God has given us this pleasure as a reward for doing it? It's like, you know, unfortunately a lot of Christian and other faiths on the planet believe that it's very painful to live a life, and they see a life of restriction and a life of control and a life of moral restriction and so forth, but actually it's not like that at all. When you truly connect with God and you truly get educated by God and you change your will to love, actually you find that there's a wide open scope of pleasure that you can receive. So pleasure is a large thing. Now, what's the extension of pleasure? Like pleasure over a long period of time, happiness. So there's also happiness. It's very rare to see people on earth really happy. And if we're honest with ourselves, happiness in our personal life is also quite a rare occurrence. Right? So imagine your ability to be happy every single moment that you're alive. Every single moment. So awake and sleep. No, I don't agree, Deidre. He is not happy all the time. In fact, I know that he's quite unhappy in a lot of ways. So it's a lovely facade, but he hasn't given it up yet. All right. So the reason why I raised that for the people in the video is because she was pointing at Glenn and saying he's always happy, but it's not always the case. Okay, and we're not talking about a facade of happiness here. We're talking about true inner soul-based feeling of joy and happiness. Okay, now those two motivators should be probably motivation enough, yes? Yep, but that's not all. There's more. Okay, so let's have a look. Firstly, let's look at issues of scale in terms of what are the benefits. So I'm going to write down this word scale. Scale from small to big. So what are the small, you could say minor benefits? Well, there's minor benefits of physical perfection. That's a minor benefit. Well, it is a minor benefit. Your physical body, you know, is the least part of you, isn't it? Even though most of you believe it's the most part of you, it's the least part of you. But imagine that. Imagine having a physical body where there's no aches, no pains, no lines, no wrinkles, we call them, right? No need for beauty creams or makeup or any of those things. No need to cover over anything. So the scale goes from that small, what I'd classify as minor physical area, right the way through to soul-based universal issues. Like, you have no idea at this point the capability of your soul when it's living in harmony with the will to love. And there are spirits in the spirit world who have reached the point of a soul union state, and it's impossible for them to describe to you the power they have in that place, right? And hopefully, like in the experiment, myself and Mary and you know, six other soulmate pairs are in, one day we might be able to demonstrate that state. So you get a bit of an idea of that. But because we're in an experiment, that's not a guarantee, right? So, but hopefully we'll be able to get to that state at some point so that we can demonstrate what that's like to you. So you have an idea of the scale of your development in love and how huge it is in terms of the universe and your movement around in it. Yeah. So there's the issue of scale. Then there's the issue, let's call it sort of scope, which is more, let's focus on the scope in terms of the, so let's, in this case I'm saying it has a personal, intimate effect on your life. So in other words, you become a different person and your most intimate relationships become different as well, and all governed by love in that place. So that's a personal and an intimate part of this beautiful process of developing your will to love. But then it expands to like global and even universal issues with regard to everybody developing in that direction, if everybody chose to, of course. So again, it's a huge scope where things can be completely different. That would be fantastic, wouldn't it? Like, so if you can imagine yourself that every single emotional relationship you have, as long as that relationship is with another person who has also developed their will to love, that the only things that you have in those relationships are joy and other qualities such as joy, happiness, contentment, and so forth in every single one of your relationships. Now, most people say today, they say that, you know, besides death, which is the most trauma that the majority of people on the planet ever experience in their life, ironically, after you've passed, you don't think it's a trauma anymore, but that's the thing where the death of a loved one is generally treated as the most trauma that you can experience. Aside from that, the next most traumas are things like divorce and breakups of relationships, right? And imagine that you had a guarantee that your relationship would never break up for the rest of your existence. That scared some of you. It's like, oh no, I'm stuck with them for the rest of my existence. But imagine you catch up with the other half of yourself, I doubt, after you've done that and work your way through some of the issues that you're going to face doing that, that you'll want to separate, and God's made this beautiful long-term plan for you to not have to do that. So that brings me to the next part of time, you know, like you have firstly immediate benefits, like there are immediate instant benefits for developing a will to love. You automatically start gaining more knowledge and more awareness. You start to become more sensitive to other people around you. You start to be able to feel yourself better and feel other people better. And a lot of these things can be quite instant in what happens after you've dealt with certain things. You have an instant response to that and change occurs. But then there's other things where there's like eternal blessings to you for developing your will to love. And in fact, in the future, it's highly likely that those who haven't developed their will to love as God loves are going to be quite limited in their development in the future, because the gift is quite, I'm quite certain the gift will be withdrawn. God's love, the gift of God's love, the source of your education, will be withdrawn at some point in the future, just so that the people who have rejected it will understand that it is a gift. And that means that those particular people may have to wait tens of thousands of years until that gift is offered again. Who knows how long that may be, right? And there's a reason for that, because we need to come to appreciate that love is a gift. It's not a given, it's a gift. When somebody offers it to us, we need to learn to accept it, because it's such a gift to receive somebody's love. And to receive God's love, what an immense gift. So we have these beautiful eternal benefits, and they may not always be there, or they may come in ebbs and flows, and we have an opportunity to catch this wave, you could say, but maybe we decide not to catch this wave, and then who knows when the next wave will come? I don't know. We have opportunities now. So what I'm getting at is there's opportunities that come up as a result of you choosing to love now. That if you don't love, the opportunities are not there. Does that make sense? And so certain opportunities only come with you developing your will to love. Opportunities that you will never have if you don't develop your will to love. So that's a positive benefit. And one of the biggest one, and one of the things that most of you at this point don't understand the importance of, but to me is a huge benefit of developing your will to love, is having a consciousness of my own immortality. New Age people on Earth have these theories about the fact that we, you know, can't die. But these theories are only just theories. And in fact, once a person passes and works their way through the many spheres of the spirit world, you get to the point, usually around the sixth sphere of the spirit world, where you realize that you possibly could die still. You could possibly cease to exist. And the reason why that is a possibility is because change is universal in God's universe. Change is the universal thing, and people who get to the sixth sphere and then stop changing, they actually now are fixed, and therefore nobody really knows what's going to happen to them. Does that make sense to you? No one knows whether they might be transformed into something else, right? Nobody knows what's going to happen. And they themselves do not know that they actually are immortal. So they hope they are, but there are, in fact, entire universities in the sixth sphere discussing that particular issue. And there's so much theorizing about the issue of immortality. And the reality is, it's only after you receive divine love to the point of becoming one with God that you're actually conscious of your own immortality. You know you cannot ever die. You know you cannot ever be transformed into something else. You know that your existence is now cemented in eternity. And the security and safety of that knowledge, you just can't imagine what the security and safety of that knowledge is until you've experienced it. You know, most of us, we talk about this frequently with you, but most of you are afraid of the physical death of the physical body. But imagine if you were also then concerned about the death of your soul, or the transformation of your soul into something else. That's how most sixth sphere spirits, once they become conscious of this particular issue, that's why many of them are concerned. But imagine once you got to the point where you're no longer concerned about that, because you know that your soul is immortal. that you can never die. You can, you're now a fixture of eternity, and you exist longer, and you have the potential after that to exist longer than any planet, any sun, any physical matter has ever existed. So scientists at this stage believe we've existed 14 to 16 billion years, in terms of physical matter, and you could potentially exist for longer than that. Well, when I say potentially, it's a guarantee that you will once you become at one with God. Right. Now, for us on Earth, that's probably something we don't consider very frequently, right? But these are all the benefits of developing my will to love. Yeah. So if we go to Diane on this side and then Gary on that side.
So if those spirits in the sixth sphere developed a desire to resolve that issue emotionally,
mm-hmm.
they would discover the answer.
Mm. If they also developed a desire to connect to God personally,
yep.
they would discover what's going on. But because they have this same arrogance, this same self-reliance, same level of arrogance where they've become very dependent on their progress being what they have chosen to do rather than what God is doing with them, as a result of that particular self-reliance, they've now, basically, they might even have an intellectual concept of God, but they certainly don't have an emotional one. And as a result of that, they have no awareness or knowledge of all the things they're missing out on. Yeah.
Yes, and that's the same self-reliance that we now have an opportunity
to remove.
To remove.
That's correct.
Yep.
Yeah. Yep. Gary, thanks.
I guess they're sort of stagnant in the sixth sphere. If they're there for thousands and thousands of years, can you slide back down the spheres again, or is it?
Not really, no. They do what you do in your personal life frequently. And you know what that is? You move from side to side. Do you know what I mean by that? Well, in other words, you change one type of life for another type of life, which is actually a sideways lateral movement without any growth. You haven't processed anything emotionally, you haven't changed, you've only changed your life. You've only changed the things that you do in your life. You haven't actually changed you, right? And most of you have been engaged in that process for a long period of time, and that's what you call change. And that's not what I'm calling change. Change is actually growth in your soul, where you actually change, you get rid of things that impede you in your growth, and you take on new things that are completely new that you've never experienced before. So for many of you, change is like changing homes, or changing schools when you're a child, or changing jobs, or those kind of things. And those kind of changes are often, in your mind, challenging enough. But that's not the kind of change we're talking about here, because those kind of changes are lateral. They don't often result in growth from God's perspective. And this is what the six sphere spirits are engaged in, lateral changes and thinking things are changing when things are not really changing. And they know it's not changing when they try to enter the seventh sphere. Then they realize they can't get there. And then they know there must be some kind of impedance to that process. Right? It's like, and this requires awareness, the development of awareness, just like the kind of awareness you're going to have to develop when it comes to becoming aware of your sin. Same kinds of awareness. No, they don't realize they're sinning in the biggest possible way. Sin against the Holy Spirit, biggest sin you can commit. And it has the biggest long-term effect in your entire life. So whenever you sin against the Holy Spirit, you have no chance of immortality. You have no chance of progress beyond the sixth dimension. You have no chance of ever having a union state with your soulmate. You have no chance of ever being completely, supremely happy. You have no chance of any of these events, right? And you think that where you're living is great, but you have no idea of what could be greater. because you can't even expand your awareness enough at that point, because any expansion of awareness beyond that point requires your soul's engagement. Does that make sense? And so for the majority of people who stay in that place, they feel they're happy. But it's like a person who's going to kindergarten believing they're happy, not knowing all these other experiences could be happening to them if only they chose to graduate from kindergarten and go to school, you know? Yeah, Suzanne?
I was listening recently to an older talk that you gave, and you were sharing about the things that happen in the spirit world that we have no idea of. And you were talking about that movie, You Can Train Your Dragon, and you were talking about children in the spirit world mm-hmm. having the understanding of this, and that they could create dragons, and they were out there having a blast, mm-hmm. you know, hooting around on these dragons and everything. And it just popped something in my heart, because I thought, that's beyond my imagination.
It's yeah, incredible. Yeah. There's so many things that are beyond your imagination, but you know, this is one positive thing about imagination, is you can choose to imagine a whole heap of things, but I can guarantee to you that no matter what good things you could choose to imagine, something better has already happened in the spirit world, that, and something better will probably potentially happen in your life, but only if you develop your will to love, right? Because those kind of things don't happen in the first sphere or the second, but by the time you start getting your third, fourth, fifth, sixth, things start happening, different things start happening. But the same applies for the progress beyond those places. All these things that are unimaginable for us here on earth start happening. And the key for you to understand is that as long as you embrace constant change in a positive direction, they'll actually end up happening for you. Right? And that's where we need faith. Need faith, and you'll gain this faith by engaging progress now here on earth and feeling the positive effects of those changes in your life here on earth. And then you'll realize that, if I do something like that, I'll end up with that. What imagine if I progress even further? What am I going to end up with then? I don't even know what that might be, right? And someone like myself or others of the 14 would come back and says, this is what happened here and this is what happened to us there. And you go, I can't even believe that. Until you actually go through the experiences and you go, he was telling the truth actually. Wow. You know. And the key is to have some faith in that sort of process. So we go to Barbara, thanks. And Lani.
When I was about 11 or 12, we were invited to go to a Billy Graham type crusade.
Yep.
And I was only going because all my older sisters were going. And the build up to it all was about, if you receive this blessing, you'll have immortality and pleasure and happiness throughout your life. And anyway, I was the last person to go down and I never got any.
Yeah.
So I had that person making all those promises to me back then.
Yes.
And now I have you making the same promises.
Yes.
Yeah. And it's very disturbing.
Yeah. Yeah. I understand the disturbance, but at the end of the day, perhaps both of us are right. Like I feel... this is how faith has to be. You have to slowly grow it. You can't be expected to have an immense faith when you begin, and you can't be expected to know how to develop your will when you begin, and God doesn't expect either from you. But if you choose to grow it, you will eventually get to the point where your past experience guarantees your view of the future experience. Does that make sense? Yeah. And this is not what's happening for many of you, because you've had disappointing experiences in the past. Remember, we talked about this. Remember in the first 2 days, I talked about the reasons why we don't have faith. The reasons why. A lot of them are to do with the fact that we've been disappointed many times in our childhood when somebody promised us something. So I'm not saying you have to believe what I'm saying. I'm saying at some point when you exercise faith, you will believe it. And you not only believe it, you'll have personally experienced it, then you'll believe it. For a lot of things, you know, it requires a personal experience before you actually will accept it. And what I'm suggesting to you is if you engage your will, then you have the possibility of having these personal experiences. But if you never engage your will in a positive direction to love, then those personal experiences are definitely going to elude you for the rest of your existence. Right? And to you, for you then, the disappointment will be real if you choose to do that. And what I'm suggesting is, no, you could use your will differently, engage another set of experiences, and those experiences, eventually you'll prove to yourself that these experiences had validity. And you'll actually do things that you can't even imagine yourself doing at this point in time. Right? But this is why the 14 came back, and I know we're not maybe doing that good a job of it at this point, but we wanted to demonstrate to you the changes that can occur over periods of time as long as you exercise your will to love. Now, I think we've already illustrated that to you to a degree, but not to the point of what it's like to be at one with God, but we've at least illustrated it to a degree at this stage. Right? What we'd like to do is, and this is what our important task is that we're trying to engage, is we are engaging this process so that we can demonstrate to you the truth of what we're saying. Now that might happen, who knows, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, I don't know how long it will take because it's an experiment, but you could engage the experiment now and see if changes happen in your life without waiting for me to demonstrate what the end, well, what it ends up like looking, you know. Like imagine if you waited 20 years, you decided at this stage, well, you know, it's all just raving on really at the end of the day. It's all just words and, you know, nothing. There's nothing really demonstrated at this point. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to wait, and if it turns out that this guy who's calling himself Jesus actually ends up being Jesus, then I might do something about it, right? And what I'm suggesting you do, what if that is 20 years' time? Some of you will be dead. And so you'll have to do it in the spirit world. Some of you will still be alive, but you've wasted 20 years of your life because you had an opportunity to do it now. But my suggestion is choose to love now. It's not, and there's plenty of rewards for doing it, personal rewards. Like I said, surely these two are enough to motivate you to do it. But if that's not enough, then what's going to be enough? And you know what is often enough if that's not enough? There's the level of pain and suffering you have as a result of following completely the opposite course. Then that has to be enough. And that would be unfortunate. Because what I notice is that most people on this planet, rather than being motivated by these things, because they have the same feeling of disillusionment, Barb, that you have, they are only motivated by these things. That's all they're motivated by. And there's plenty of people who have embraced God's truth after being motivated by these things. There is. There's heaps of people in the hells who have embraced God's truth because they were motivated to remove these things from their life. Now, I sort of feel like if you're not already in enough pain and suffering to be motivated to do something different, then that's unfortunate because that means that it's highly likely you're going to wait until you're in more pain and suffering before you do anything. And what I'm trying to do in this discussion with you is say, hang on a sec, instead of being motivated by the pain and suffering that you eventually will feel if you keep doing things the way the world does it, the pain the world's in will be a mirror and a reflection of your own. And unless you're going to be motivated by something different, then unfortunately the pain will have to get to a certain level before you do something. And what I'm suggesting to you is that doesn't have to happen. You could be motivated instead by the desire for pleasure, for desire for happiness, true pleasure, true happiness. You could be motivated by the desire to become immortal, to experience a lot of things and imagine yourself potentially experiencing a lot of things that you can't experience now. You could be motivated by those desires, but the average person on the planet will go, that's all just, you know, that's all just feeding a bunch of crap to people, right? And so what are you left with if you don't believe that? You're left with this motivating you to change. And it's your choice what's going to motivate you to change. So Barb, are you in enough pain and suffering to change? Is the question I would ask you. Sure, you've been disillusioned in the past by people who have suggested certain things to you about, you know, what the rewards of doing something may be, but surely your personal pain and suffering is enough to motivate you right at this point. Does that make sense? And if that's not enough to motivate you and these other things are not enough to motivate you, then I suggest to you, you'll never be motivated. You won't change. And the pain and suffering is build. Remember in our previous discussion, no action is actually a sin in itself. The pain and suffering is going to build. You get to the point where the pain's too intense and you decide, well, I've got to do something. And in a way, that's a blessing too. Because if we're not motivated by the happy things, isn't it great that eventually we're motivated by the avoidance of the sad things in order to become more loving and more truthful in our personal lives? Nina, thanks.
So I was sort of sitting here going, well, yeah, I'm sick of the pain and the suffering. And there's disillusionment when we can't believe in the pleasure and the happiness and the benefits to work through.
So that's an emotion, isn't it?
Yeah.
So there's doubt and disillusionment, mm-hmm. and trust issues we have about it as well. They're just emotions that we need to process through, right? So let yourself process through them. Yes, you have been disappointed by the promises of the past. I understand that. Mm-hmm. I do. But what I would say to you is, look, God didn't promise you those things. And of course, if somebody on earth or in the spirit world promises you these things, you ask God what he's promising you. And once you find out what God's promising you, and you have any trust in God, you'll come to understand that actually God's trustworthy. You can have faith in what God's promising you. All I'm doing is telling you what God's promised me. That's all. Right.
Could you explain a bit more about sinning against the Holy Ghost?
Sinning against the Holy Spirit? Yeah. Well, it's sort of off topic, Lani. But can you see that the Holy Spirit is the connection of truth? And if you reject truth and love from God, then you're sinning against the Holy Spirit. While you do that, you have no hope of ever receiving God's love. So you can see, and what did we say right back at the beginning? We said receiving God's love is the key to your education in love. So if you can't receive God's love, and remember God's love is the higher source, if you can't receive God's love, then your education in love is going to be forever limited, forever. Can you see how sin against the Holy Spirit it has the biggest personal effect on your life than any other sin you can commit? You understand?
And that's why you said, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven. Yeah.
Seek first God's love and all these other things will be added to you. Yeah, is what I actually said. If we go to Peter, thanks. Over here, sorry, Lily. She's rushing around.
With the pleasure and happiness, with our passions and desires, does it sort of open up and expand as we go through that process?
Of course.
Is it like the lid's just opening, or are we suddenly getting more awareness of what our true nature is?
Yeah, well, at the moment, what affects your passions and desires the most are your fears. So your fears are determining your life to a great degree at this point in time. And this is one of the things you don't realize. And that's why we had the 2 days in the middle talking about your fears, because it's your fears that are having the greatest negative impact on your desire, on your desires. You do have desires. Some of you have even know what they are. But even if you don't know what they are, it's all because of fear. It's all because you're afraid of something. And you know, once you work your way through those particular things and remove those things from you, your passions and desires will become obvious, and of course they'll be a great source of happiness to you.
Yeah, and then your creativity is expressed from that.
Through that, yeah. And then you've got not only that, but the masculine and feminine expression of that in the one soul. So, you know, so you get to see it from the female half of the soul, and you get to see it from the male half of the soul as well. So you get to understand it as it truly is, you know, that how that passion gets expressed through those particular traits, those sexual traits that exist within the whole complete soul. As you know, as the two halves come together, the passions and desires increase further, and the combined activity of those two parts of the soul increases exponentially as this growth occurs.
So that's why the intensity just keeps getting more and more too.
Yes.
In a beautiful way.
Yes, but can you see that if I'm scared of overwhelming emotional intensity, none of that will probably happen, right? So another resistance. So again, we go back to that area about what are we resisting, and what negative effect are these resistances having on our life? At the moment, many of you believe that these resistances are good for you. Yeah, this is a problem, right? You believe your resistances make your life safe. So you believe not knowing the truth makes your life safe. Not having faith makes your life safe. Not having to do something that's out of the box makes your life safe. Not having to feel emotions makes your life safe. None of those things make your life safe, by the way. They actually make your life more traumatic. They make your life more difficult. They make your life quite unhappy. In fact, they make your life unsafe from God's perspective. And yet we're there believing completely the opposite of that, because we have completely the wrong definition of all of these things. Completely the wrong definition of love. And we're not connecting to the source while we have these emotions, and so we have no hope of ever improving our definition under those circumstances. Well, our alternative is to have some faith that God is good. What is it in Arabic, baby? It's Allah Akbar, isn't it? God is good. God is good. Now just settle with that for a moment. God is good. Let yourself feel that God is good. Don't just dismiss that statement. Let yourself feel it. God is good. A good parent would want to give you good things, wouldn't he? A good parent would want to give you things that would cause pleasure and happiness, wouldn't he? If you truly believed that God is good, what would you do? Wouldn't you have some trust in what God is offering, and some trust in love and trust in truth under those circumstances? Let yourself feel that God is good. Let yourself believe God is good. Let yourself act as if God is good. Right? Let yourself make that decision inside of yourself to trust God first. Let yourself believe these things. Because if you do that, you have not only the prospect of being educated in love, you have the prospect of all of these beautiful rewards. Surely a good parent would offer, if a good parent could give you these things, surely they would they not? Like if you had the ability to give your children complete happiness, complete security, a taste of their own immortality, you had the ability to help them live forever, you had the ability to do all of these different things, wouldn't you do it if you could? So why do you believe God can't? Right? If you believe in God, you must also at some point come to believe in God's goodness. Right? So this is why we focused your attention right back at the beginning on your beliefs about God. You see, most of us have quite negative beliefs about God, and as a result of that, that's affecting our choices and decisions to use our will to be loving. It is, and of course, if we don't decide to use our will to be loving, we're not going to get the rewards of being loving. And the rewards, it's not like God saying, I'm going to reward you with the carrot and belt you with a stick. It's not like that at all. The rewards of being loving are a part of the universal laws. They're all pre-established for you. They've been established before the creation of the universe. Like, so God, you know, it's a given. It's the framework of the universe is based around these principles. But of course, if we dismiss all that, and we go, no, well, I don't believe God is good, I don't believe God can be good, and so forth, then where are you going to get your education from? Same place we've already got it from, isn't it? And most probably with the same result, right? So what I'm trying to do here is try to encourage you to understand that you can trust in God's goodness, you can trust in God's love. There are rewards for doing so, but the primary rewards that there are so many of them that it's like you can go on for days about each reward and describe to you in detail each reward. We've done presentations in the past. There's actually a 4-hour video about the eternal benefits of connecting with God from years ago, and that was 4-hour discussion. I went through a lot of the rewards of receiving God's love, but that's only most of them. It's not all of them, you know. So, and at some point you've got to learn to trust that God is good, have some faith that God is good, and that a good parent would want to give you whatever that parent can give you, given the law, given the circumstances, given what they're teaching you. Right? And God's like that, just like you would be if you're a good parent too, right? Yeah. So that's the main thing I'd like to say to you here. There's a lot more we could tell you. We could start listing a lot of the other rewards and so forth. But I feel, you know, the main point's been covered really with regard to this discussion. Would you like to ask any questions about it before we end this part of the discussion? So, Evira, thanks.
Why has this topic generated the most emotion in the room?
Whenever I start talking about God being good, you all start having some kind of awareness that maybe that's true. And it triggers quite a lot of emotion. And then, of course, God's love can flow, and that triggers you even more. Right? And then we've got our spirit friends that are here when I'm talking about this issue. The whole condition of the room gets elevated to another place as well. So you all become more open to feeling that perhaps that's true, more open to fear, to being inspired, influenced by your spirit friends who know that to be true and so forth. So naturally you're going to feel more emotionally from it. You want to say, Mary? You can say what you want to say.
I was just going to say that it obviously exposes how much we're living not considering that.
Yeah.
Because as soon as we start to consider that God is good, it brings up all kinds of grief and fear, and it's a challenge of a false belief that we're obviously living in day by day.
Yeah.
And I think that's why it becomes so emotional. So little truth is actually spoken on the planet about God that when somebody does, and it's good news, it's good truth, it's like a huge overwhelming relief coupled with the confrontation of all the error that we're carrying around and the grief we're carrying around as a result of that error.
Linda, thanks. Sorry, down the front. Kate. Now Kate's running around for us. Thanks, Kate.
This is more of a thank you. When you made that comment about how we don't have to have a whole heap of faith straight away.
Mm-hmm.
And just the way you said it, it was just so loving, and it made me realise how much I beat myself up because I don't believe that. I don't believe that, you know, like, I feel I have to be there now.
Yeah.
I need to.
So when we talk about perfection, many of you sort of want to be there right now without going through that growth period. And a lot of the times it's because you don't want to feel like attacked or denigrated or all that through the growth period. God's not doing that to you. It's only other people doing that to you, right? What God does is say, no, God's saying to you, look, I've created a universe where you will eternally grow. How fast you grow is completely under your control and your decisions. You don't have to grow as fast or faster than other people. You can choose to do it at your own pace. But what God's also suggesting to you is don't not do it at all. Because not doing it at all is going to cause a lot of long-term issues for you, both in terms of what happens here on earth, but also what happens in the spirit world after you arrive there. You're far better off choosing to do it than you are avoiding doing it. And you will receive benefits now doing it as well as in the future doing it. So why wouldn't you do it? You know, you've got to consider why you wouldn't. But not only that, you're allowed to make mistakes. You're allowed to not have any faith and grow some. You're allowed to not know any truth and learn some. God doesn't expect you to know everything. You know, this is the problem with your education. Up until now, most of your education has been based around in the Western world. You've gone through different schools right from the time of 4 or 5 years of age, right the way through to, you know, many of you have gone to university. You've gone right the way through to 22, 23, 24, if a doctor, 25, 26, 27. There's this long-term education period, and all of it has pretty much been threatening in the way that you were measured and graded and you were scaled and you were tested and you were, you know, put pressure on, and there was a lot of sleepless nights and difficult times. And this is the way you think God is. But God's not like that at all. Like, in fact, God believes that kind of training or teaching is quite cruel, in fact, and very anti the soul. And so what we need to come to understand is God's more gentle than that and more loving than that, and God's going to educate you differently. And what you've got to do is stop this, you know, remembering the way you've been educated. You know what I mean by that? You, at the moment, you're sort of imposing the way you've been educated on what you think God's doing with you. And it's completely different. Like, God's education of you is completely different than the world's education of you. And in the world's education, it's like, you know, this is what I say to you. You do not understand the scope of the differences in definition. You don't understand it at this stage. At this stage, because you're so closely aligned to the world's definition of love, the world's definition of truth, the world's definition of education, and so forth, you're so closely aligned to these definitions that you cannot imagine there being a completely different way that all of these things can be engaged at this stage, right? Now, God knows that. And God's trying to pull you, draw you, with the carrot of love, right, on the end of his fishing rod, if you think of it that way. And you think about, you know, if I'm the donkey, he's there putting my carrot in front of me, yeah, and there's no stick at the back, right? Now, what you're used to is the carrot and the stick. You're used to the, and to be frank with you, the majority of you are so used to the stick that most of the time you're not even aware of the carrot, right? Because you're so used to the stick. You're so used to the punishment. You're so involved in the punishment that you now punish yourself. That's how indoctrinated you are in this method of learning. You now punish yourself for not being able to learn quick enough or fast enough or to your own, you know, to what you feel your capacity should be, or in comparison to other people, or whatever it is. You're now your own stick. That's how bad it is, right? That's how this indoctrination of training and education on this planet has affected your life. And what I'm suggesting to you is that God's not like that at all. God's just drawing you along with God's love, right? Trying to draw you along, trying to show you where you can be led, and the key is for you to allow the process to occur. Yeah.
Well, it's like that's what you've been saying all along.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just
I think it was just the way you said that then, really, it really hit me. Mm. And I didn't get it before. Mm. And I just realised it's like, you know, I want to be that big solid oak tree, but I haven't even planted the seed yet. And I need to plant the seed, and then I need to water and nurture the seed. Yep. And be patient while it takes time to get to be that big solid oak tree. And
yes, I agree. But you also need to take actions that you don't resist it from growing.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, to me, many of you plant the seed, water it a bit, and then when it gets to be a little tiny seedling,
you pull it out.
You either pull it out accidentally, or you put, you know, strangleholds on it and turn it into a bonsai bush or whatever, you know. That's what you do. You're so intent on turning it into something else, you just don't let the natural growth occur, right? And this is a problem that you face with our life. And we're doing all this because the world's done this for centuries. Like, you're not going to break centuries of resistance, centuries of unloving behaviour by taking a pill today and it'll be gone tomorrow, or by imagining yourself to be in a different state today and by tomorrow it's all done. It's not going to work that way. Progress requires change to occur, and change requires it requires time, but it also requires effort. And the key for you is to, okay, give yourself the time, but make sure you put in the effort. Yeah. Now, many of you are giving yourself plenty of time without putting in any effort, and that obviously is not going to work either. Mm. Yeah.
Just thank you.
My pleasure.
Really, thank you.
Yeah. So hopefully from this discussion, you've seen firstly, you know, some of the rewards that are there, many of which you have no appreciation of at this point in time, and that's okay. But surely the pleasure and happiness potential is going to be a reward enough. And even if that isn't, the avoidance of pain and suffering surely would be enough, would it not? To motivate you to engage your will to love and change. So and it's not only your pain and suffering. It's other people's pain and suffering as a result of what you've chosen to do that will change as well. So you not only get the benefit of your own pain and suffering, like improving in terms of, you know, getting less, but we also get the benefit of the people around us no longer suffering because of the choices we've made and the decisions we've engaged. And if you can't believe in any of the other benefits, at least accept that fact that God is good. And if God is good, then it means that there must be good things that come from connecting to a good God. And that should draw you along and give you enough faith to get motivated to engage this will properly, to actually engage it to the point where you decide and finish up experiencing the rewards of developing that will. Does that make sense? Okay. Left everyone a bit emotionally stunned there. So what we're going to do now is just have a 10-minute break. And some of you might just need to take a bit of opportunity to have a bit of feel within that 10-minute break. And then we're going to come back and have our last discussion with you before you go.